Hello, I'm Diane Trees. The night sky and all its mysteries has been a source of inspiration throughout the ages. While not all of us make a career of studying the stars, our next guest is a NASA scientist and astronomer. Dr. Amy Mainzer searches the skies and even has an asteroid named after her. She also hosts the PBS Kids show Ready, Jet, Go. Dr. Mainzer joins us now. Dr. Mainzer, welcome.
Hey, thanks so much.
Can you describe what your job entails for NASA?
Well, I work on a mission called NEOWISE, which is a pretty long acronym. It stands for Near Earth Object Wide Field Infrared Survey Explorer.
That's pretty impressive.
We love our acronyms at NASA. But the short answer is that basically I'm an astronomer, and I use this NEOWISE space telescope to look for asteroids and comets in our solar system.
How did you get interested in science? What inspired you for this, and how did you land with astronomy in particular?
I actually got interested in astronomy when I was a really little kid. When I was about 6 or 7 years old, I was fascinated with Greek mythology. Actually, my mom got me one of those kid books on Greek mythology. And I remember she took me to the library and I looked in an encyclopedia. In an encyclopedia, you always find double meanings for a lot of the Greek mythological characters, like Andromeda. If you look it up, there's the Greek mythological figure, but then on the next page is the galaxy. And I remember when I was a little kid looking in the encyclopedia and seeing for the first time the photos of some of these amazing, beautiful things in space. And I was hooked after that. And I always knew after that that that's really what I wanted to do, was to be a scientist.
So you knew at an early age and pursued this then all the way through with your doctorate into a PhD with astronomy.
Yeah, that's right.
That's pretty amazing. So how did you switch then, or not switch, but include the scientific end of things and then moving into television and a media role?
Well, it kind of got me thinking after a while that if I was interested in science when I was a little kid, that's probably not unusual, right? I mean, a lot of people probably got their start when they were fairly young, too. I mean, lots of people come into science as older adults, but the fact is a lot of scientists get interested when they were kids. In other words, kids can make lasting, lifelong decisions. That's kind of amazing if you think about it. So what it means is that if we want to reach the next generation of scientists, it's a good idea to start when they're young.
Well, how do you see yourself then as a media personality? Is it as an educator, a role model? Are you bringing science, popularity to science?
Well, I guess the way I look at it is that science is a part of our everyday lives. It's just a part of our lives all the time. It governs the way that we live. Gravity is what keeps us from flying off the surface of the earth, right? And when I look out at the world, I think there are so many wonderful, amazing things. Even just the color of the leaves of grass, right? I mean, that is dictated by the laws of physics. And if you can ask kind of the simple questions, well, why does it look green? Well, it's because that's the way the light scatters off of the molecules. That's actually a very profound and interesting answer to a pretty simple question. So to me, it's all about kind of looking at the world and finding those everyday things, but seeing how actually quite extraordinary they really are.
Let's talk about your role then with the PBS Kids show Ready, Jet, Go. I think it comes across your passion and your ability to share that with people. What is your role, or multiple roles, with the show?
So I serve a couple purposes for the show. I'm the science consultant, so that means I help to try to infuse the science curriculum throughout all the episodes. And this is one of the great things about working with PBS, I really love this, is they're committed to education. So this isn't just a cartoon, it's a learning experience. And I give the writers a lot of credit. They make it so fun. You know, there's songs, there's music. So that helps to make the curriculum far more about just memorizing facts. That's not what this is about. It's about learning the process of science. How does it work? And that's what we try to infuse into the show, that natural curiosity that kids have. So that's one of the roles. In the other role, I also serve as the on-camera host for the interstitials. These are little short live-action little bits that we do to just, you know, demonstrate science and try to take kids a little bit on a tour behind the scenes of some of the really cool and amazing places that scientists get to work.
It's fun to watch. I enjoyed it when I was watching some episodes. Now, as the science consultant, the curriculum consultant, what do you want to bring to the show? What's the goal here?
Right. So one of the things I think that's really important is to try to give kids a sense of what science is really like. It's lively, it's interactive, it's a process of solving problems with your friends, essentially. It's working in big teams of people to try to solve difficult problems. And that's very different, I think, than you know, what kind of people might think science is like, about memorizing lists of facts and stuff like that. And that's not it at all. It's solving problems. It's interactive. And it lets you tackle some of the most difficult problems. And what we want to show with Ready, Jet, Go is that it's possible to be part of that process. Even if you're a kid, even if you're six, you can go out and ask questions. How does this work? How do I figure it out? How do I work with my friends to figure it out? That's what we kind of want to get across.
You're dealing with a very young age group. What kind of experiments are you doing on the show?
One of the things that's amazing to me is kids have so much capacity to love and understand science. So we actually present some very advanced concepts on the show. We have an episode coming up that talks about moonquakes. I mean, I'm a professional planetary scientist, and I didn't know about moonquakes until fairly recently. So we're really trying to get cutting-edge stuff in there so that kids get up-to-date information. When I was growing up, it was really hard to find out what was happening in space. I mean, it was the flow of information was kind of difficult. So for us, we have an opportunity to teach kids about some of the most up-to-date things that are happening in space and Earth science, like the Pluto mission, like New Horizons. So we actually held off writing those episodes until we could get the new images back from the New Horizons mission. And I'm so glad we did, because they were great.
And just so absolutely brand new and enlightening for everyone. How do you, though, you're part of the curriculum with the consulting. How do you take these complex ideas, though, and drill them down, make them fun, but make them understandable? These are really young children.
Yes, they are. And the thing is kids love space. They're natural scientists, right? They're curious about everything. They constantly ask questions. And, of course, that's what scientists do. The difference is, as professional scientists, a lot of times we use jargon. Mm-hmm. So a lot of this is, it's not so much that you change the concepts or you weaken the concepts, it's just we try to translate the jargon, that's all. I mean, if somebody can use a very confusing set of words, I can say, you know, let's see, the star formation rate in the Orion Nebula is, you know, but the point is I can say that in a more conversational way of saying, there's a very rapid number of stars that are being formed.
How did you first get involved with television and different aspects of the media?
Well, at JPL, we get a lot of media requests because people are interested in what we're doing, which I think is great. And in one case, they just happened to throw one of the requests my way. And it was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed talking to people through the medium of television because people love to learn about space and science, and this is one of the most accessible and easy ways to do it. It's a really powerful means of communication. So, as I like to think about it, you know, when you work on science, it's like going on a fantastic vacation. You see these amazing things. And of course, when you get home, you have to share it with everybody and maybe bore them with some slideshows. But it's that idea of trying to share what we learn.
Were these mainly directed then at adults?
These are mostly for grown-ups. But I've long wanted to do something for kids because, for one thing, I got interested when I was so young. And I would have loved to have had a show like Ready, Jet, Go, because I was obsessed with space.
With that show then, looking at the children at that young age, for content, what is important for them to be learning, and how do you engage them to do that?
Well, one of the things that's really important to me is to try to break down some stereotypes about science. There's sort of a misconception sometimes that science is about just memorizing long lists of facts, and that's not it at all. Science is interactive. It's about figuring out what problem to solve and then figuring out how to solve it. I mean, they don't even tell you what the important problems are. You have to figure it out yourself. And so I really want to try to show kids that science is for them, no matter who you are, what your background is. Science is a part of your everyday life, and you can be a scientist if you want to.
It's really fun.
Do you think then that there's a misconception of most people have of what a scientist is, or perhaps what we study in school is not necessarily what you're doing as a profession?
Yeah, my experience as a practicing scientist is quite a bit different than I think the popular stereotypes. It's for one thing, it involves a lot of teamwork. I mean, we work in big groups of people, and that's really different. I mean, that stereotype of the lone scientist in the lab, you know, that
with a white coat.
Yes,
yes.
With a white coat. That's really not how it is. It's teamwork, it's interactive, it's solving problems together. And that's a lot of fun. It's really, really different than what I thought it was.
you enjoy this so much, it comes through. What do you find is most enjoyable, or what gives you the satisfaction of working with the children?
Well, I think what's great about working with kids is they're natural scientists. They can't help but ask questions. They want to know how everything works. And that's science. That's what we do as scientists. We just ask questions. It's just we kind of never stop doing that, you know.
That you haven't. You are such an integral part of making Ready, Jet, Go inspirational and attractive to young children. How do you see yourself as a long-term role model for increasing science diversity and interest with children? Do you look at it for a long term as something you want to do?
Well, I'm certainly having a wonderful time doing this now. It's been really fun, and thanks so much. I mean, it's great to think about, hopefully there are other people out there who are hearing the message that science is for them, that everybody can do science. You may not do it professionally, but you can be interested in science and you can use it every day in your life to make decisions, to help interpret the world. These are the tools of science, critical thinking, and that's what we want to show in the show.
Dr. Mainzer, do you think that it's more important now to teach science to children than perhaps when you were growing up or with my generation when I was growing up? Is it more important now?
Well, the world is facing a lot of big problems like climate change that are absolutely essential to address using the tools of science. So we need a scientifically literate public to be able to address these big problems. Fortunately, there are solutions out there, but we need everybody's brains to help figure them out. We can't afford to waste anyone's talents. And it's kind of all hands on deck in terms of using what we know about science to figure out these problems. So I'm hoping that somewhere out there, there are some very young kids who are going to be our next generation of scientists and engineers who will figure these things out.
Thank you for using your multiple talents to reach out for so many people. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
That's our show for today. Join us next week when we again explore issues important to Central Florida. Thanks for watching. I'm Diane Trees.